So there were 12 blemishes, and we've only actually discussed one. Let's go ahead, though, and read this again, because it's only a couple of verses. Leviticus chapter 21, and beginning with verse 16. Excuse me. And the Lord spoke unto Moses, saying, Speak unto Aaron, saying, Whosoever he be of thy seed in their generations, who hath any blemish, let him not approach to offer the bread of his God. For whatsoever man he is that hath a blemish, he shall not approach. A blind man, or lame, or he who hath a flat nose, or anything superfluous, or a man who is broken-footed, or broken-handed, or crooked-backed, or a dwarf, or hath a blemish in his eye, or be scurvy or scabbed, or hath his stones broken, no man who hath a blemish of the seed of Aaron the priest shall come near to offer the offerings of the Lord made by fire. He hath a blemish, he shall not come near to offer the bread of his God. He shall eat the bread of his God, both of the most holy and the holy, only he shall not go in into the veil, nor come near unto the altar, because he hath a blemish, that he profane not my sanctuaries, for I, the Lord, do sanctify them. And Moses told it unto Aaron and his sons, and unto all the children of Israel. All right, in the last class, we were talking about blindness. And I really planned on finishing that off. But I had some other notes on another thing, and then some things that came to my mind that I felt it would be good to share. and that's found over in 1 Samuel chapter 3. If you'll turn there with me, 1 Samuel chapter 3. Now remember, this is saying, and the first thing that it says that will disqualify you is blindness. And we talked about this reality of seeing. And when I was in Bible school, I noticed, and you know, sometimes you play around with numbers and whatever in the in the book. But I noticed in 1 Samuel chapter 3 and verse 7, it says, Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, neither was the word of the Lord yet revealed unto him. Now this is interesting because he's already in the priesthood. He's just a child. But he's already in the priesthood. And you know, there are some who are like children. They haven't matured. And it says clearly that he didn't know the Lord, neither was the word of the Lord revealed unto him yet. But down in verse 21, which it's chapter 3, and we read verse 7, 3 times 7 is 21. Verse 21 says, And the Lord appeared again in Shiloh, for the Lord revealed himself to Samuel in Shiloh by the word of the Lord. Several things to notice. One is you can be of God, you can be of the right people, which is Israel, and still not know the Lord. You can be of God, you can be of the right people, and still not know the Lord. Well, how do you get saved, or how do you become the right people without knowing the Lord? We're talking not about knowing of his existence or knowing of his salvation. We're talking about knowing him. We're talking about really knowing what he's like, and to know what he's like according to these scriptures is to have him revealed. That's exactly what Samuel needed, and it's exactly what every one of us need. We need him revealed. Now, it even gets specific here. He did not yet know the Lord, nor was the word of the Lord yet revealed to him. And that is, Christian or not, folks, come on, man. God says, I want to reveal my son in you. That's the New Testament, but that's the fulfillment of anything Samuel or anyone else saw. And I want to reveal him in you, but I want to do it by the word. In other words, I want the Spirit of God to open your eyes to exactly what the scriptures are saying, not the letter. Because Israel had the letter. What is the letter? What it says, ink on white paper. Am I right or wrong? The letter is ink on white paper. Or it can be slightly brown paper for that matter. But it's nonetheless, the letter is what you can read with your own eyes. You don't need the Holy Spirit. You don't need God to reveal anything to you. If it says do this, you just do it. That's the old covenant. The new covenant, and all this is clearly described in 2 Corinthians chapter 3. The new covenant is when God begins to rent the veil and you begin to see him. And these things begin to be fulfilled in you by the life of another. His name is Jesus. God wants to reveal his son in you, not just to you. You can have the son revealed to you and still not have him revealed in you. Now, so all this is going on. This is all surrounding this whole third chapter of Samuel needing to come to a revelation of Christ. But there's more to it than that, and that is, let's start at verse 1 of chapter 3. 1 Samuel 3:1. The child Samuel ministered unto the Lord before Eli. Now, one thing I want you to notice, it wasn't until verse 21 that he had him revealed. But he was ministering to the Lord. If you haven't had Christ revealed in you as your life, have you ministered to the Lord at any time in your walk? Well, yes. You're of God. You're not only of the right people, you're of the priest generation, if you will. And you've ministered unto him. And notice it says he ministered unto the Lord before Eli. Who is Eli? Eli was the high priest at that time. Who does the high priest represent? Jesus. Okay. So, and says, and the child ministered unto the Lord before Eli, and the word of the Lord was rare in those days. There was no frequent vision. There was no, the word vision here is relating to seeing. Amen? It's not talking about having a vision. You understand, you know, some people have a vision. I had a vision of an angel. I woke up and an angel was beside my bed. Well, I mean, I happen to be one that, according to the things I've read in the scriptures, there's probably angels are all around us. I mean, you know what I mean? I mean, it's just because you saw one, doesn't, you know, it's like, I saw what is. But we go, oh my God, you know. But having a vision or having a vision of hell, well, isn't that a sweet thing? You know, I had a vision of hell. Was that, never mind, I don't even want to get into it. We're talking about seeing vision that sees, and specifically this context is talking about seeing the Lord, and who's it talking about? Priests. Samuel, Eli, it's talking about the first blemish, blindness, and it's talking about becoming an active priest, not a priest in name only. Okay? So it says, the word of the Lord was rare in those days, and there was no frequent vision or no frequent seeing. And it came to pass at that time when Eli was lying down in his place, and his eyes began to grow dim, that he could not see. Anybody ever read these scriptures before? Well, he's disqualified right there. He is a priest that's blind. Huh? That's what it says. Keep your place there, but just over in the next chapter, if you'll just turn over there in verse, what I'm about to read you is after the Ark of the Covenant is taken and many other things have happened. In other words, it's not falling quickly upon this. 1 Samuel 4 and verse 15. Now Eli was 98 years old, and his eyes were dim that he could not see. Let me remind you of somebody like Moses, who was 120 and he could still see good. Now, folks, if you wear glasses, that's fine. We're not talking about that, you know. I'm sure there's going to come a day where I'm going to need them. But in the meantime, I want the eyes of my understanding open. I don't care if I'm blind as a bat in relationship to having needing glasses or something like that. I need to see Jesus. I need the true seeing. So all these blemishes, they're not physical problems. All right, back to 1 Samuel chapter 3. So it says clearly, as he's lying down, and it says, and his eyes began to grow dim that he could not see. And before the lamp of God went out in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was, and Samuel was lying also to sleep, that the Lord called Samuel. Notice, the priests are supposed to keep the lamp of the Lord burning. That's the seven-branch candlestick. That's their job, is to keep that thing going. To be able to keep it going, you need one main thing. You need to be able to see if it's lit or not, or if it's about to go out. And it was about to go out, and God came and relit it. Do you see? It's literally worded that way. Eli's laying down. He's the high priest. He's laying down. He's totally unaware that the oil is running out, and it's been running out in Israel for years and years and years and years, man. It's getting darker and darker and dimmer and dimmer, and his vision and their seeing of the Lord is passing away until it's about to move into a place of oblivion that nobody knows you need to see the Lord. That the Lord has to be revealed, verse 7, verse 21, right? And so it says, and he's laying down, and his eyes are dim that he cannot see, and before the lamp of the Lord went out, before it went out, just before darkness comes upon the whole place, God speaks to Samuel. God starts lighting the candlestick, the church. God keeps a light. He doesn't let it go out. He's a good priest. He's a good priest. So he immediately begins to speak to Samuel. And he begins to declare, the end of this old priesthood is about to happen. It's coming. Eli, his sons, which are all the priests, Eli is the high priest and his sons were the priests, it's all about to be put out. They're about to be put to death. The old is passing away right before you. And you, Samuel, are like John the Baptist. You are the bridge between the old and the new. You are the one who will anoint the true king and start a whole new thing, David, King David, the man after God's heart, the man who comes to the word and doesn't say, oh, I got it, it's the letter, whatever it says, I understand it. He comes to the word and says, open thou my eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of thy law. He says things like, I delight in the law of the Lord. He knows that God has to open his eyes. David. So God's about to put away the old priesthood, the old king, everything that's ruled by the flesh. Everything that is ruled according to the flesh as a principle, everything that is ruled itself as being ruled by the flesh will rule by the flesh. If your flesh rules you, you will rule with your flesh. Does anybody see the need to come to a revelation of Christ? My God, we've got enough flesh ruling. We need Jesus. We, the church, we as individuals, but we, the whole church, we need the Lord to be revealed. And so, you know, Samuel doesn't know. He runs to the high priest. He runs to the highest one he can get to that he's aware of. He's a priest, though he's a young boy, so he runs to the high priest. But he is going to find out that the true high priest, Jesus himself, is speaking to Samuel. And he is enlightening him. And he is preparing him. And he's bringing him into a whole new realm and going to make him the transitional person to bring everybody into it. Praise God. Praise God. Well, there's lots of problems at that time. In verse 13, this is what the Lord said. Well, verse 11. Here, you know, well, if you don't remember the story, basically Samuel runs to Eli and says, "Did you call me?" And he says, "No, I didn't call you. Go lay down." So he goes, lays down, and the Lord speaks to him again. And he runs back to Eli and says, "Did you call me?" And he says, "No, I didn't call you. Go lay down." And the Lord calls Samuel again. He gets up and runs to Eli and says, "Did you call me?" And he says, "Next time you hear that voice, say, you know, speak, Lord, for thy servant heareth." So little Samuel lays down, and the Lord speaks to him, and he says, "Speak, Lord, for thy servant heareth." And God begins to deliver to him, not, well, you take a little ashes and you do this with it, and you take a little blood when you got this situation and you do this. No, God begins to reveal to him the message of the cross, starting in verse 11. And the Lord said to Samuel, "Behold, I will do a thing in Israel at which both the ears of everyone that heareth it shall tingle. In that day I will perform against Eli all things which I have spoken concerning his house. When I begin, I will also make an end." There you go, Alpha and Omega. The Lord, when the Lord comes in, it's the beginning and the end for us, because he is the beginning and the end. "For I have told him that I will judge his house forever." Huh? Forever. That's the old man. "For the iniquity which he knoweth, because his sons made themselves vile, and he restrained them not." Huh? You see that? He's the high priest. He represents Jesus. And he moves on behalf of the people to free the people from what offends them. And yet, he is bringing forth things that offend them. Can I get amen? His sons were not just his sons. They were priests. And so, the main work of the priest is to take away sins and to take away flesh. All of us are priests. All of us. What is our main job? Well, obviously, yes, to enter into the Lord and to bring the people to the Lord, and as the high priest did, bring us right in. But it deals with, hey, let's instead of working to crucify a lamb or a goat or a bullock or something like that, now we continually present the lamb that was slain, yea, resurrected and seated on the mercy seat. That's how we take away sins and flesh. We don't, you know, just go through some little ritual over and over. We declare the truth as it is in Jesus. And so, you know, instead of being raised as true priests, they didn't when they got the flesh, they didn't burn it on the altar. They didn't burn it all up on the cross. They ate it. You can read the story. They ate it. Well, what's the old saying? You are what you eat. They ate it. You're supposed to burn that stuff up, not live off of it. You know, as a priest, God knows what he's doing. And so, God is watching this whole thing. And he's going, this whole thing's got to be judged. There has to be judgment. They haven't seen the judgment. They haven't accepted the judgment of the cross. So I'm going to have to bring judgment on them. And so he's looking at that, and the altar, the cross, come on, the cross has become a place to eat flesh and to get flesh instead of losing your flesh. That's what just accepting a message can do. Man, it's got to be more than that. I mean, the high priest, he's supposed to show them how to live based on the altar and based on sacrifice and this sort of thing, you know? You don't ignore that. Jesus is still the lamb slain on the cross, on the throne. Amen? He's still the lamb slain. He's not, it doesn't say he's the lamb resurrected on the throne. It says the lamb slain. Because the cross has to continually be applied so that there is no room for flesh to glory or come forth. So, you know, and the thing is, God's looking at these boys and going, my God, they're not just going to be priests. One of them's going to be high priest soon. You know, that doesn't shock us, but that really shocks God. He's just going, this is horrible. This is just the worst scenario possible. They've gotten familiar with the altar. They've gotten familiar with sacrifices and offerings and stuff. They've gotten so familiar with it, they've become friends and made their flesh friends with these rituals instead of letting the cross strike the death blow. And they fall as dead themselves so that they can lead others into death, which is into resurrection. You know, there is no resurrection unless there's a death. You can't have a resurrection without a death. Is that right or wrong? There is no resurrection. You know, there's just, I feel better. You know, I was feeling bad, you know, I got better, you know. No, there has to be a death. And a death blow. And you have to, as a priest of God, you know why you're a partaker of the altar? You partake of the altar. Doesn't it say that in Hebrews? You become partakers of it, man. I mean, you understand this thing. You're part and parcel with it. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I. Christ liveth in me. Praise God. So, you know, for a person to step into the role of a high priest, they have to be conformed to the image of Christ. You cannot allow flesh to run rampant in you. You do in you, you're going to let it run rampant in the people. You can't. You just can't. And I'm not talking about, well, then jump on it and crucify it. I'm talking about seeing the Lord to such a degree that you are no longer living, but Christ lives in you. That's the goal. Because if you allow it, you know, people may not see it. You allow something here, you allow something there, you do that. They may not see it, but what's happening is, eventually, man, it's all going to crop up and pop up and, you know, feed it long enough. You live for the Lord. And it's not a horrible thing. It's a wonderful thing. When Paul said, I'm crucified with Christ, he wasn't going, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, but not I. Christ liveth in me. You know? He wasn't freaking out over that. He was thrilled to be rid of that guy. Saul. Had the same name as the guy that tried to kill David. Saul, before the cross, he said, I am Saul. Now he said, I am crucified, thank God. Nevertheless, I live, but not I, it's Christ. Woo, there's the victory song. Christ liveth in me. And the life I live in the flesh, I live by that faith that I'm crucified and Christ lives in me. He loved me enough to crucify me. See? Well, the Bible calls that good news. It's only bad news to bad priests. That's right. You know. I mean, you heard of that movie called Bad Santa? I never saw it, but well, there's one worse. Bad priest. My God. And that's what these boys were, man. They were taking junk from people and pushing them around and getting away with all kind of stuff. And so there was this word of the Lord, no, word of the cross that came to Samuel. And God is saying this. If we just let everything go, one of these boys will be high priest. And God says, we're not going to let it just go. None of these fellas are going to be high priest. They won't live. Not Eli, not Phinehas, not Hophni. None of them are going to be alive. That's just the cross. That's not the end of it if you embrace the cross. If you don't embrace the cross of Christ, if you embrace the cross of Christ, there's resurrection that comes with it. His name is Jesus. If you just are drugged to the cross without any desire for oneness, ouch. That's sort of a mild version of it. The scriptures that we read over in chapter 4 says that Eli, you know, that he was the high priest and that he was an old man and heavy. Old man. And fat. How do you get fat? And I'm, you know, you, especially these boys and daddy, you eat a lot of flesh. Flesh, 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 flesh. You are not supposed to feed your flesh. Talking spiritually. You know, some of you think, thank God I'm in a Bible school. I got people that'll look over my shoulder and go, uh-uh, don't do that. No, you can't do that. Oh, that's against the rules and all this kind of stuff. Folks, there's only so many rules. We have people here that have been getting away with murder for years. So you can too. Isn't that great? There's not enough rules trust me, there's not enough rules to rule your flesh. There just isn't, you know. Somebody, who's it going to be? Somebody has to stand up for the cross and say, you know what? I'm not going to expect the rules or everything else to keep me in line. I need to die. Oh, the pleasantness of the flow down from the high priest. How good and how pleasant it is. But you got to be one. You got to be in tune. You've got to want this. You know, we're not talking about beating yourself or being some sort of, ascetic? Ascetic. I've never given it right. It's been, how many years have we known each other? 20 some odd years. And every time I want to use the word, I look to Mallory and ask because I don't remember. Ascetic, meaning flailing, you know, beating yourself, doing things to keep your flesh down. Oh, man, you can do things for 3 years to keep your flesh down. And when you graduate, it's like the girdle breaks loose. That's sort of visual, isn't it? But nonetheless, you know, it's just get out of the way. Hoover Dam just broke, you know. Again, I'm talking spiritually that if you're, you know, trying to whip your flesh into shape, good luck with that. How's that working for you? You can hold it back and do all this stuff, but you, when you get the opportunity, your flesh will come forth with vigor, vim and vigor. Man, the time to go after the cross is when you're in the mood, and do it while you're in the mood until it becomes habit, and then do it as a habit until it becomes a lifestyle. It's just what you got to do. These sons are looking at their dad. Well, he's the high priest, and he's an old man. Well, he's the high priest, and he's heavy, old and heavy. He was an example to them as to how to live. And so, this is Eli. He's the high priest. How does the high priest get that way? Well, apparently the priesthood added flesh to him. I mean, we're talking spiritually here, you know. Apparently, it was adding flesh to him because he seemed to be growing leaps and bounds. He's getting bigger, but his eyesight's getting less. Keep your eyes on Jesus, folks. Keep your eyes on Jesus. So, there's the old man sitting there, and so here, you know, you look at him. You see how he raised his sons. You see that, you know, he's not just a failure as to how to raise his children, but how to raise up priests. Folks, you're priests. Every one of you, if you're born again, you are a priest. Every one of you, if you're born again, you're a priest. I'm sorry. I'm not going to jump your case over stuff. I'll be more merciful than anybody. But I will, as much as in me is, not let you just go with the flesh. I will tell you the truth. I will preach hard and heavy and fast and continue to do that because it's our only hope, our only hope, Christ in us, Christ in us. And if it's the hope of the world and what we believe to be the message, man, we've got to be the forerunners of this thing. We've got to be in on it. We've got to want it. We've got to, you know, and you know what? There is this thing called self-deception. Is there not? There is a self-deception. We all have done it, you know. I mean, you know, I think the scriptures talk more about deceiving yourself than the devil deceiving you. I mean, it's amazing, you know. Oh, you know, the devil comes up and says, well, I think I'm going to work on you. And you go, you don't, you know, no need to. I'm taking care of that myself. Go mess with somebody else. I got myself all deceived, you know. But it's even easy to sit in a place like this and hear and run around with everybody and think that you're okay when you're allowing your own flesh to do stuff, to do stuff, to do stuff to others, if you're letting, you know, there is a certain pleasure of letting your mind, even though you would never do something, letting your mind run wild. Well, I can just see myself railing on that person and, you know, really jumping them good. And just meditating on it, it's like chewing a big old steak for you. Mmm. I'm going to savor this. I'd never do it, thank God, because the cross is in my life. But man, you know, Jesus said stuff like, you know, they make you go 1 mile, go two. You look on a woman to lust, you know. I mean, his were steeper because the cross puts us to death. See, that's why it's, you know, and then gives us his life, and then his life overcomes. So I'm just saying, you know, I realize that you're not going to deal with everything in your life in the first 3 years of Bible school. But in Bible school is a good time to get 3 years of training how to deal with your own flesh. I'm serious. Don't be thinking about the great ministry you're going to have on the day you graduate. You know, I'm going to graduate, and I'm telling you, I'm going to be God's gift to the church. Good luck with that one. You know, I tell you, the one thing you need to be concentrating on is that I may know him. The power of his resurrection, the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death. That's it. That's where you should live. Right there. Not for someone else. And you should, you know, this is a tough one for some people. I don't really see how tough it is, but you should say, thank the Lord for every one of these people that drive me nuts, because it's helping me to gauge and barometer my life every day and show me that I still need Jesus, and it's keeping me humble and hungry. Man, that's their purpose. Paul said this light affliction works for us. Most churches are praying away their affliction. They're praying away their workers. Can I get an amen? This light affliction worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory, while we look not at the things that are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. So, how does this stuff work for us? Every person that rubs you wrong or does something to you and hacks you off, or situation that arises, that is your Father loving you. That's the Holy Spirit coming to answer your prayers. That is the Lord wanting you to be his kind. Isn't it? Do you want to be his kind? Do you want to be after his kind? That's what it's going to take. It's going to take allowing all things to work for this end, for this good. You know, we say all things work together for good. Folks, it tells you what the good is, that we might be conformed to the image of his Son. That's the next verse. It tells you. It's not working for your good to make you, you know, happy in Bible school or comfortable in the church, or, you know, that's not the good. That's the good off of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Good. Are you with me? Oh, it's good, all right. It's the wrong good. It's the tree God said don't eat of, and you're trying to get God to shove it down your throat and fill your belly with it. More good, Jesus. More good. Pick more of that good fruit off of that tree and feed it to me. Feed me the good. Yum, yum. Well, the good that he wants to bring about is to be conformed to the image of his Son. And so instead of being thankful, we curse. Instead of appreciating the heart of the Lord, we want to get out of, you know, instead of appreciating the workers that he sent, you know, isn't that a good way of putting it? You know, instead of appreciating, you know, he sends several workers our way. And we go, okay, boys, what I want you to do is help me clean my room and do so and so. And these workers, instead of helping you do that, start buffeting you. a messenger of Satan to buffet your flesh. But Paul prayed, God, take it away. Take these workers away. Take these buffeters away. God said, they're my workers. No, no, no. And he said, man, I finally learned. These things are making me so weak that the only hope I got is the strength that is Christ, not him strengthening me anymore. There is a difference. All of us have prayed for God to strengthen us. And I bet you almost all of us have experienced the strength of the Lord. Amen? That he's strengthened us. But he wants to weaken us, not strengthen us, so that Christ can be the strength of our life. So that when we get in that situation, we go, you know what? This is beyond me. I can't handle this. This is too big for me, but it ain't too big for you. And, you know, the average Christian way of saying that would be, you know, and God helping me, this won't be, you know. I forget, I remember reading in somebody's bathroom a little plaque said something about, you know, problems or so-and-so, but me and God together are majority or something. What? Have you never seen the cross? God's the majority. You're not even a minority. You're dead. You know. Well, I'm just a minority. You wouldn't go through so much pain being a minority if you were dead. You know what I'm saying? I mean, all the, well, I'm just a minority, I get left out, I mean, I'm old, I got gray hair, people don't appreciate me. Just die and you won't, you know, let Jesus live. Then you're not old or young. It's Christ. And it's exciting because how you get in those situations, you can't do it, and you say, how is God going to do this? How is he going to break through that? How is he going to overcome in this situation? Man, I cannot wait to see the Lord come through. I've done that before. When it was overwhelming odds and surrounded me and just went, you know, looked at the circumstances. That's what it means. You're circumferenced in. Circumstance. You look at all these enemies, you go, well, man, this is going to be a doozy. I can't wait to see how the Lord does this. This ought to be exciting, man. I can't even imagine. I can't even come up with a scenario. It's so cool because, man, I'm going to see something I have not seen, ear have not heard. For those that he loves, well, let's just watch let's just stand still and quit working and be still and see the salvation of God, and seeing him just pull the rabbit out of the hat time and time again, and you just go, oh my God, that was so cool. You know, it's like, how many times does God get applauded other than church when we're, you know, at the end of a good song, we feel like applauding? I mean, just, you just live in life, and you just stop and you go, wow, yeah, that was good. I mean, I know this sounds dumb, but I'm blessed tonight because I had some negative, bad things happen over the last couple of days. Really, really bad stuff. Stuff that could send me into a tailspin if I'm not careful. And so it went bad, and then bad, and then worse. Like 3 or 4 of them. And so, you know, you just sort of, okay, man, I wasn't applauding this time, but I'm kind of going, well, we'll have to see, you know, we'll have to see. And sure enough, he brings way more, he gives me back what I lost and gives me way more. And what's cool about it is he gave me way more for others. It wasn't really for me. It was for others. I was just going, you're so good to me, to others. You know? I mean, in one sense, it's just work for me. But I know, it's not I know, it is. It's for others. And I just went, wow, Thank you for the trials. Thank you for what went wrong, because I never would have found much more. I would have stayed with better. You know, because I left good, now I'm into better, so I'm okay. But there's much more of the Lord. But we always, you know, we're doing bad and then we start doing good. That's it for us. Whew, thank God I'm out of bad, I'm into good. How about more, more of Jesus, more. I'm not satisfied with good. I want more of you. See, and you just keep your heart. I mean, who, come on, let's just talk as friends. Who better to keep you motivated than you? You know, I mean, obviously the Holy Spirit's at work in there and the life of Christ. But you know, you have to be in tandem with the Holy Spirit. You know, and when you say stuff that lines up with the word, he works. But if you're not going to be motivated, if you're just going to be lethargic, it's like, okay, I'll go my 1 mile. Or, okay, praise God, I'm going to go my 1 mile. I'm going to do it, and I'm going to do it good, and I'm going to so show the Lord and so show these stinking Romans, I'm going my 1 mile, and I'm going to be, you know, at the end of 1 mile, and we go, and he says, let's go 2, and you go, excuse me, I gave you everything on that first mile. I don't have anything left for 2. You know? You know? Well, if it's you, you probably did, you know, gave all you got. But there's more. And that's exactly, you know, people like David, people like Samuel, they were motivated for the Lord. Thank God Samuel had a mom that wanted the Lord when she was barren. And she didn't say, well, I'm just barren. And I mean, you ought to read that story. You know, and here's Eli again. He's in on that. He's sitting there watching her. She's praying, but he can't hear. Couldn't see in the other story. Now he can't hear. So he can't hear her words, so he can't tell she's praying. So the high priest comes up with a great deduction. You're drunk. She wasn't drunk. She's praying. She's the furthest thing from drunk. But, you know, that's what kind of priest you're going to be if you don't get some seeing of Jesus. You're going to see wrong or not see at all, or you're going to hear wrong. And she's barren. Samuel doesn't exist and wouldn't have existed. If somebody, this woman, went, I got to have the Lord. You give me a son, you give me the son, and I'll give him back to you. I'll spend my whole life giving you back the son. See, we say, you give me a son, and I'll live happily ever after. I got Jesus. You look just like me. You look just like your daddy. You just bless me, you know. Hannah took that baby and said, okay, dude, when you get weaned, you're going into the ministry. You belong to God. You know, we always say, I'm going to give my child to God. How about that? I mean, you give them to God, you know. And that's what she said. You give me a son, and I'll give you the son all the days of my life. I'll never hold on to him for me. Is that cool? God gave you a son. His name's Jesus. What are you doing with him? Oh, Jesus, I'm just so glad to have you in my life. It just makes me feel so fulfilled that I got you. You know, living like a selfish little mother that all she's after is feeding her own flesh and feeling good because, you know, before she was tormented by everyone else who was not barren. And now she's not only not barren, she's got not only got a child, but she got one from the Lord so that she can torment everybody that tormented her. Glory! It's just pitiful what the flesh is like. It is ugly. You don't believe me? You try this. You go look in a mirror. Oh, I'm sorry. So, that's exactly right. So, you know, the failure of ministry and pastors and churches, the failure relates to not raising up priests. Not raising up priests. Everybody's supposed to be a priest. Oh, I know they're teaching people to pray for the sick and calling that raising up priests. I know that they're, you know, teaching people to do a little counseling and stuff. Folks, being a priest is living for God and taking everybody else's sin to the cross. You been doing that, or you been, you know, pointing out their sin? Ah! You know, can you see a priest? You know, every day, all day long, people step through the tent door with a goat or whatever because of their sin. Imagine a priest who all he does is notice sin. Ah! Oh! There's nothing but sinful people coming in here. This is horrible. I'm surrounded by sin and by yucky people. My God. I can't believe. Have you seen so-and-so? Did you see what they did? Did you see what they said? Did you hear what they said? Are you aware of so-and-so in New Creation Church? It's horrible. I can't believe the state of this church. Well, you know, the priest didn't sit there and do that, and all of them start backing up, heading toward the veil. Oh, no. They're coming. You know? Like some sort of zombies coming after them or something, you know? Shaun of the Dead or something. No. They went, there's somebody with a problem. I got to get them to the altar. You're a priest. Stop pointing out problems and start getting people to the altar. And then help them work all the way through until they're with Jesus face to face. Isn't that the right way, man? You know, there's enough condemnation. We can beat each other to death. Oh, glory. Isn't that a wonderful thing? That's what some churches are doing, man. You mess up and that's it. If you know, here's just the bottom line. If you don't recognize that you're a priest, here's the thought. Well, you know, Randy's a priest. You know, it's the thought of the laity and the clergy. Well, Jim's a priest. I'm just a lay person. I'm just a regular person. I'm not a priest. So why doesn't Jim do something about the problem? I mean, why doesn't the priest fix this? Well, you should say it like this. Why doesn't the priest fix this and I'm the priest? Why don't I get them to the cross? Why don't I work with them until they recognize the death of the Lamb? And why don't I walk with them until they're, if you will, through the veil and in the presence of the Lord until they're being changed into that same image and their problem is no longer. See, we always look at the problem instead of realize they need to go to the altar. The answer isn't to point out, you know, it's like somebody walking in there with a lamb to get, you know, get it killed on the altar, and then we sit there for an hour and point out their problem. And they're going, Are you a priest? Yeah. Well, could you just like help me get to that altar? No, we need to talk about your sin. Does this make any sense? My God. The failure of the church isn't sin. And can you see that? The failure isn't sin. The failure is to make priests, or you're actually not making priests, you're already priests, to bring people into the understanding of the priesthood so that they can get people to the Lord, to his death and to his resurrection, to the altar and into the Holy of Holies. The purpose of every priest is to help others. He lives to help others. He lives to help others. He lives. He does not live to condemn. He is the one place, the tabernacle of the Lord. He is the one place where the condemned can come and get some help. Can I get an amen? Where the and they're going to be given right off the bat a heavy dose of the cross. But that's what they need. A heavy dose of Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Paul said, as a priest, God forbid that I glory except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. I mean, that's not just a glorying for himself. That is a man who has recognized, not that he's called to the ministry, but that he's called a priest by God himself. God calls you a priest. Not there's a calling to the priesthood. You are, if you're born again, you are a priest. God calls you a priest, not he calls you to priest. If you understand my bad grammar. It's not a calling to do something. He called you what you are. You are my priest. Now imagine if all the church everywhere, if all the people in all the churches everywhere recognize that fact and recognize that that's why I'm here, that's why I exist, and we're all going to work together, all of us priests, because that's what they all had to do, didn't they? All the priests and Levites, they all had to work together. We're all going to work together. And can you imagine this? Can you imagine that the priests in the tabernacle, all the priests and Levites, there were a bunch of them, were there not? Were there not a bunch of priests and Levites? Can you imagine any of them ever having personal problems with any of the other priests? Or do you suppose it could happen? Hypothetically, of course. Well, then, not only that, they all live together. They're all surrounded the tabernacle. They're all right there. You know, they're. Do you suppose that the very thing they were supposed to do to the people out there, they couldn't do for one another? I mean, you know, could you imagine that? That, oh, they're dedicated to help those people out there who have no name and no face. They're just poor people needing Jesus. But you, there's no excuse. Well, there is no excuse. That's why you got to get them to the altar. You know? But see, there's a difference between getting somebody to the altar and you getting them to the gallows. The one you built. Getting them to the guillotine. The one you built. So you can chop their head off, or you can hang them, or you can dispose of them, you know. And that's the way some people preach the cross. The cross, they are, you know, the example I saw was, this is years and years ago, is that you can stand there with the cross and you can beat people with the cross. You're just beating them with the cross, trying to kill them. Or there's the cross has power in itself. You throw it out there, and before too long, if you keep preaching the cross, God will bring them to death with Christ on the cross. The main thing is you love them and you want them to know the truth. You don't beat them with the cross. And I'm not trying, I mean, you may feel beat after I preach. You probably do. My goal is not to beat you with the cross. That's the opposite of what I'm really, it honestly is. It's the very opposite of what I'm trying to do. I try to throw the truth out there, and whosoever will find it. We'll get it. We'll want it. We'll want the Lord. We'll want the altar. We'll want to make their way all the way through until they see the face of the Lord and are changed into that same image from glory to glory. That's the goal. That's the purpose. So you see the incredible problem of blindness. That's why it's number one on your hit parade. Or shall I say number one on your hit list. you got to see Jesus. You got to come to a revelation of Christ. Okay, let's take a break and we'll come back and talk about something other than blindness. We don't talk about baldness. Actually, I don't have that problem, but